Welcome, everyone, yet again to another edition of Overrated. I'm Michael J. O'Connor.
James Fluty.
And we're continuing on with our month of movies about music that are not musicals. And this week we did did it win a Golden Globe? I think it won a Golden Globe. Winning movie.
Oh, Hugh Grant was nominated for a Golden Globe.
Yeah, Florence Foster Jenkins. With Meryl Streep and Hugh Grant and Simon Helberg, kind of different. It was a different tone than we've picked in the past.
Yeah,
yeah.
We do a lot of classics, a lot of stuff that we've already seen.
Yeah,
that fits the theme. You know, a lot of so this one was something we've never seen and is not a classic.
Yeah,
it was enjoyable.
It was
a good film.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's a little different.
Yeah, it was.
A little more mainstream than we generally want.
Yeah, exactly. yeah, it was, like I said, I watched it last night and it was a lot of fun. It's kind of, I'm sure that there's a word for it, which maybe you would know, but where they take like a real true story and they kind of spin a little gold into it. You know, make it a little more interesting than, of course, it probably was. You know,
every time they do a biopic ever,
sure, what you're thinking. Sure, yeah, yes, exactly.
Every single film that has ever said based on a true story is
right.
Not actually that true,
right? but so I'm sure that there's some of that, but it was based on a true story, and Florence Foster Jenkins was a real person.
Mm-hmm.
And this it kind of spoke to some of my interests because. I'm a really big fan of, I guess, what you'd call like outsider music, and I think that she would have been considered that. She was there's a great quote I can't remember. I think it is at the end where she says they may say that I can't sing, but they can't say I didn't sing, and I love that. That's
good. There is a kind of individual that creates art because they love it.
Yeah.
Because they're attracted to it. And they do it whether anyone is going to like it or appreciate it or understand it. And they oftentimes, you can't recreate that.
Right.
So for the you know, one of the easy connections you can make is The Room, which we've brought up a few times.
Sure.
Tommy Wiseau, who made this film that is almost incomprehensible.
Oh, yeah.
It is funny when it's not meant to be. And it's a classic now. People love it. Yeah. It still sells out theaters. I love it. I've seen it many times.
More times than I care to admit. I watch that movie all the time, dude.
Well, you know, Seth Rogen was talking about, you know, he's making a film based on the making of it.
Right.
And he was talking about his liking of it. And he's like, I've seen it more than I've seen Network.
Sure. Right.
And Network's a phenomenal film.
Yeah.
But you can't recreate that. You could not make a comedy that is in the vein of The Room intentionally.
No.
Because it's the earnesty that creates those film and creates her singing, her album.
Yeah.
It's the fact that she genuinely loves this and is genuinely trying to make something of value for people, and that they succeed, but not in the way that they mean to.
Right.
And I hope that people appreciate it on a level past snarky laughing at them.
Sure. Sure. That's the thing is although it may be funny, and it certainly is, you know, I don't like things, and we maybe have talked about this before. I'm not a big fan of like Sharknado or stuff like that. That's, or Snakes on a Plane, stuff that's intentionally bad doesn't do anything for me because there's no honesty to it. There's no heart to it. You know, it really is just, I think that to me feels snarkier than liking something like Florence Foster Jenkins, the singer, for the obvious passion there is there, you know, for better or for worse, you know.
I do find with certain movies that, like, Snakes on a Plane is a really good example of it, is that I want them to pick a lane.
Right.
I want them to either make a scary film or a B-movie parody.
Right.
I don't want this sort of, like, which is it, and here's a little B-movie part, but then here's some action scenes and that. Like, just pick a lane.
Right.
And with Snakes on a Plane, I don't know if it's been a while since you've seen it, but during the credits or after the credits, they show the bloopers and the outtakes. And they show this guy overacting.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, make it bigger, make it bigger. And so, like, he's going like, damn you, snakes. And they didn't have that in the film.
Right.
And it was not only the funniest moment, but I'm like, why did you not make that?
Right.
That would have been so much more interesting.
Totally.
To just go, just do it. Just go full force into this B movie thing. Because otherwise, what do you got? Just sort of a somewhat, you know, I guess they're trying to go for like an Air Force One, but it didn't really get there.
Interesting. Yeah, no, it did not get there.
No.
It got far, pretty fucking far from there.
Was it Air Force One I was thinking of? Nicolas Cage?
Oh, Con Air.
Con Air. Con Air is what they're
now. Yes, I would like to see Air Force One with Nicolas Cage as the president, perhaps a remake. That I would watch over and over and over again.
No, Air Force One took itself very seriously.
Yeah, oh yeah.
It was Con Air genuinely seemed like they had like a spoof script,
mm-hmm.
and someone was like, let's make it a little bit more real or something, because it's so funny and it's so smart.
It is.
I think, but it's hidden under action movie tropes.
Yeah, and Dave Chappelle's in it. Steve Buscemi is in that. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, it's, and John Malkovich. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm such a huge Nicolas Cage fan. I would totally. And I feel like he does that where he picks something, and when, regardless of his choices of things that he's going to be in, which is, I don't know, 6 times out of 10, he just says, like, sure, I'll do it, whatever. He picks something and he hangs on to that. You know, we just watched the Wicker Man, and he is so good in that and so over the top, dude. When they're putting the basket on him, and
it's,
he's like,
good is the bitches. Word you're looking for?
Yeah, I think
it's
so.
It's good the word you're looking for.
I think
he's literally pointed to a scene that looks so phoned in.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, not the bees. He sounded so unconvinced of his own terror in that scene.
Oh, he's so perfectly odd. I love him.
And I like Nicolas Cage. He's in some of my favorite films,
yeah.
And he does a good job in some of my favorite films. So I'm not. I know he's capable of, but in Wicker Man, it literally just seemed like he's like, fuck, I need a paycheck.
I don't know, maybe.
Yeah, I'm just going to get through this. I have a flask in my pocket.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Oh, definitely. Definitely. Yeah, it's so funny, dude, to watch something like that, and then you go back and watch Raising Arizona, and you're like, what happened?
Raising Arizona, Adaptation.
Oh, God, yeah.
There's some others.
Vampire's Kiss. You ever see Vampire's Kiss?
No,
oh, it's great. That's funny comedy. He thinks that he's a vampire throughout the whole movie. It's great. Yeah. Anyway, yeah.
Actually, Nicolas Cage is a weird thing too, because there's this sort of appreciation of Nicolas Cage as being bad.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Like, a lot of people like to dislike him in things, and which is similar to a Florence Foster Jenkins. The mm-hmm. difference being that he actually has done really good performances.
Sure.
And knows what he's doing.
He can act. He chooses not to.
Maybe. I don't know what's going on.
I don't know. I thought maybe, so while we're on it, I brought up some clips from the real Florence Foster Jenkins so you can kind of hear what it is we're talking about. So this is her hit from The Magic Flute, which is a...
Is this the Queen of the Night singing aria?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So here we go.
Bye.
So that's
you didn't get to the best part of the aria.
Oh, here we go. Here we go.
There's literally a YouTube video of a parrot doing a better job.
Yeah, but it's endearing, you know.
Oh yeah,
you know, and yeah.
I probably bring it up too much, but when I was a comic. Mm-hmm. I began becoming a fan of fans of comedy. Like the people who just showed up, had no interest in performing, but just showed up and liked watching comics.
Right.
And they'd show up to these shows. I'm like, you know, this show sucks, right?
Yeah.
This is awful. But they would just show up and they just loved watching comedy and they would support comics and they, you know, they just loved hanging out and talking and watching the same comic perform 500 times.
Right.
And I was just so in awe of that.
Who are you?
And people? I feel like it's the same thing with like music. Like the people who aren't musicians, they just love music and they love hearing it and the way it makes them feel. And they can cry based on a performance. Yeah. And that is so beyond what I allow my emotional self to be.
Totally.
That I just, it's, yeah, I am so in awe of those kinds of people.
Right. Yeah. I think that she would have been someone like that as it's portrayed in the movie, you know, like she, just loved it and loved everything about it. And she didn't even seem to me, at least not portrayed as someone who did it for attention. Like, because there's that, you always have that. There's always the Rebecca Black Friday song. There's always, you know, the whatever reality show star that has an album that's for the attention or money or, you know, whatever. It didn't strike me as that to me is not earnest, you know, that to me is just a cash grab or whatever.
Well, she it was real that she donated a lot of money to the arts.
Right.
And that, yeah, she did support, musical theater and stuff like that for years and years and years. So there was, you know, which may not be as difficult when you have money. So it's not like I'm saying like good for her in that way, but obviously that's what she chose to spend her money on, and right. That's what she wanted around.
Right.
Maybe it was just an element of being a socialite, but certainly that's not what was portrayed in the film, and doesn't seem to be the case in the little that I've been able to find out. That's one of the things I found very interesting about this. No one really knows what the hell is going on.
Right.
Like, the more I try to research, like, the real Florence Foster Jenkins, the more they're like, we don't know why she sold out Carnegie Hall.
Right.
We don't know if they paid people to fill up the seats. We don't know if, like, people genuinely were going to laugh at her or if people were genuinely interested in her singing. Like, it's this weird mystery that still surrounds it.
It's
very bizarre.
I think it became – I can kind of trace – you know, working backwards, I can see how it would have become maybe started as people thinking it was supposed to be funny.
Yeah.
You know, and then realizing slowly, maybe people that went and saw her, oh no, it's this is not supposed to be funny. And then it kind of reaching this fevered pitch of this comedic performance is great. Then realizing, oh no, and then just going down into the let's go to the freak show kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And one of the interesting things that I was reading is that except for that Carnegie Hall performance, her performances were largely private, you know, but she did invite Cole Porter, and she knew these big figures in the New York kind of music scene.
Yeah.
And, they were respectful enough to, and enjoyed her at probably as a person, and were respectful enough to not tell her she was terrible and just like, oh, good, and clap. But then once that kind of gets out of control, and as is shown in the movie, you know, when they start playing her stuff on the radio, then it becomes more this big joke, and I can kind of see how that happens.
Yeah, and that's the thing, is that that's sort of what I expected to read.
Right.
Expected that to sort of be the general gist of how it came about, and then her sort of being in on the joke at some point. But they never really explain that, and it seems because there's not really a lot of information.
Right.
Available.
Who knows?
The what I found interesting, and they nod at this in the film, the pianist.
Yes.
At one point, he's lifting weights, and that is because the actual guy later became a bodybuilder.
Oh yeah, that's right.
And the thing I was reading though is because he couldn't get work as a pianist anymore because of working with Florence Foster Jenkins, which seems weird.
Right.
Like, that's a bizarre thing. Like, she wasn't good, therefore you can't play the piano with me. Like, that's a very strange, had nothing to do with his abilities.
No. And he's from even that recording, you know, I don't know a whole lot about classical music, but he's quite good. I don't see what the issue would have been, you know?
Yeah.
He was good enough to follow her poor timing. And, you know, you can hear him slowing down and speeding up to try and wrangle her in, you know. If anything, right, that seems like that would be a...
yeah, if you can play with her.
Yeah, you can play with anyone. Yeah. Shit. Yeah, totally. I loved Simon Helberg playing the piano player in it. He was really good.
He was really good.
Yeah.
Really good.
He's funny.
He also did his own piano. That was actually him playing.
Really? He's an interesting...
That was him playing the piano, and that was Meryl Streep singing.
Mm-hmm. That was interesting reading about the production of that, how she is actually quite a good singer, and about how it takes a good singer to learn how to be a bad singer.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, or at least to be able to do it sort of on cue. You know, like you could hear the good singer later in the film.
Yeah.
Towards the end, she sings quite well in sort of a hallucination. But my wife is a vocal teacher.
Mm-hmm.
She sang opera for many years.
Wow.
And the amount of knowledge she has is remarkable. Because it'll be stuff like anatomy of the throat.
Right.
Like I'll mention something. I'll be like, what is the glottis? And she'll be like, oh, it goes like this. It's connected to the subglottis. It goes over here. Like, it's just, it's remarkable. And the more you would know, the more you'd be able to go like, oh, this is what people do wrong, so I need to do that.
Right.
This is what a demonstration of the glottis coming from your dog. I appreciate it.
Yeah, really. give me 1 second. I got to check on that. We'll edit this out. Okay. So yeah, you're saying, there's more to it than just music knowledge is what you're saying. There's a whole thing.
Well, also like she knows what mistakes singers
right,
make.
Right.
So like if she were to hear a certain sound, like let's say she listened to the actual Florence Foster Jenkins, she would probably be able to go, oh, she's using too much of her soft palate here and she needs to be able to breathe for me. You know, that kind of very technical stuff.
Right.
I once saw her diagnose a problem over the phone and fix it.
Wow.
Like someone's like, she's not hitting this note, and she's like, oh, try moving your mouth in this way and breathing from here. And they're like, oh, thank you so much. And I was just like, oh my God, it's like you have a superpower.
Yeah, that's amazing. Wow, that's so impressive. Wow.
I don't know anything the way you know that subject. There's not a single thing on this planet that I have any kind of real understanding of.
Nope, not at all. I know a lot about the Muppets. But that's the
price you pay though. Like she knows so little about pulp culture.
Right.
Like all the time I'll mention something and she'll be like, I don't know. and it's stuff like she really should know.
Right.
You know, like really you don't. I'll be like the White Album and she's like, was that the Rolling Stones?
Oh, I'm
like, oh no. Oh.
Like Terminator? Not even Terminator. Wow. That's hilarious. That's kind of like my my aunt is very she's very bright and dedicated herself to like one thing. I don't really know what it is, but it's her job, and she it's something to do with business. It's not my wheelhouse. I don't really know. But
just immediately in my mind, I just imagined her saying, "I have a certain set of skills."
Yeah, yeah. it's never fully been explained. But I remember we went to my brother and my uncle, her husband, we went to WonderCon back when they had it in San Francisco, and she came along, and I remember she had no idea what anything was, and she said, it is so nice that they pay these people to come and dress up. And we were just like, oh no, these are paying customers just like us, you know. But that's so interesting. Yeah, that you dedicate yourself so much to like one thing, and
it's always funny. I'm sorry, I apologize. It's always funny when someone gets the wrong idea of a situation like that, but their misinterpretation actually makes more sense than the reality.
Yeah.
Like they pay these people. No, the reality is people spent lots and lots of money of their own money in order to dress up like a fictional character and be around other people dressing up as fictional characters.
Right.
That person learned the language of the fictional character.
Yes, on their own time, after work, after work, mind you, after a full day's work. That's what they did. Yeah.
I've always been so fascinated with the fandom culture that I kept trying to be that.
Yeah.
I kept trying to find these different things to be that level of fan of. Mm-hmm. And I had to come to grips with the fact that I'm not a collector. I'm not a huge, like, there are things that I love, Game of Thrones, Star Wars, comic books, you name them. I love them, but I'm not obsessive. I'm just not there. Just not who I am.
Yeah. I'm the same way. I like things. There are things that I have a great, affinity and love for, but not on that level. You know, you got to respect that. That goes back to the earnestness, man. You got to respect that kind of, that level of dedication to something is,
I think that was my attraction to it, was it seems to give a lot of people purpose.
Right.
Like it gives them a direction. And I was like, I want that.
Yeah.
I want to like have to own a comic and get a sense of joy when I find that issue.
Right.
You know, I wanted that. I started collecting for a little while and like I saw the appeal, but man, I didn't have it in me. I'd rather just have that money so I can go out to dinner.
Yeah. Right. Right. Well,
and also some of the people, not all of them, so don't get your panties in a bunch, collective fans.
Yes.
But some people were miserable human beings.
Really?
And they're making themselves miserable by their collection.
Sure.
By their fandom. It took over their lives. They had no real relationships. They, you know, and the idea that I was like, ooh, I want that.
Right.
Seems so silly.
Right. I write sometimes for a satire website called The Hard Times, which is like kind of like The Onion, but for like it's like a music magazine. It's like a satire music magazine. But they recently did a offshoot that's for like video games and like gaming culture. That's a satire site for that. But one of the headlines that came out recently that made me laugh so hard was someone help. I can't get past the level of Battlefield 4 where my wife says she's taking the kids and leaving. And that to me just says it all, man. It says it all.
One of the first bits I ever remember doing, and I don't think I ever did more than maybe once or twice, was lamenting that I had lost my Dungeons and Dragons character at level 32. And I said, which is horrible because you know it's level 33 where it starts getting you laid.
Oh, I remember that. That was your opener. That was your opener because you'd come out and say, you know, I'm sorry, I'm kind of down today, and you know, there's a death in my family. Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. I remember that.
Once you get Magic Missile 4, that's when women start noticing.
That's right. Magic Missile. Dude, do you still have all your books and everything, your Dungeons and Dragons books?
No, I sold them.
Wow.
I would, honestly, I would still play. I think it's a really fun game.
It is.
It's really hard to find people who play and who, and then generally as an adult, if there's a group of people that play, they don't want anyone else.
Yeah.
They're done. This is the people we play with. No, we're not taking applications. We don't want anything. Just done. No, this is us.
Yeah, that's true.
It's already difficult enough to get us together,
right?
You know, in that one time a month or a week that they play. So, like, yeah, it's pretty much done.
Right. I have a buddy that plays.
It's a bummer. It's a fun game.
It is. It's super fun. my buddy plays with, he has a couple different games going with different groups of people. But aside from him, all the people he plays with, like, all have kids and, you know, all have, you know, jobs and stuff. And so they get together like once every 3 months, like once a fiscal quarter, you know, and he's just like, it is so infuriating because there's, you make these little moves. And it's like, well, see you in the summertime. Like, I don't have the patience for that. Like, I would just be, I don't care. I don't care anymore. I don't care.
Yeah. Yeah.
but yeah, that, you do find that, and in really specific kind of subcultures, which I think music is definitely one. You know, you'll find people that are obsessive, and you know, stuff like things like Florence Foster.
Oh, yeah.
You know, yeah.
Audiophiles. Oh, I worked with a fair amount of. I worked at a used bookstore that sold records.
Oh.
And the kind of people that become obsessed with records are people that you do not want to get them started on that topic.
Right.
Because they don't know that you are giving them every signal that you want to leave now. So excited to talk about records. Oh. So like they just go and go and go. And I'm somewhat interested in this subject that they're talking about. Right. And I have to work. I have a job. My job right now. Please, please, God, stop. the audiophiles, because not only are they obsessed, there's so many avenues to go into with the obsession of music.
Right.
As I'm sure you've known many people in that circle.
Sure.
But like the people who are like, I'm obsessed with records, and then they go like, this is the kind of recording equipment they use. Like they number them and they go like, oh yeah, they were using a Z351.
Sure.
When really they should have been using a 4F56. But that was used primarily for brass instruments. Oh. See, and then this one, they didn't have that. And like, you're just, oh my God.
Yeah. Yeah. there's a lot of, I feel like maybe mid 90s, late 90s films used that kind of character a lot. I'm thinking right now of Steve Buscemi's character in Ghost World. Yeah. Yes. He's really that kind of guy. You know.
Well, I mean, to be fair, it really did seem that was based on the author. Right. I'm blanking on his name right now because he was a big record guy and he was in a bluegrass band with Robert Crumb. And I think largely that was him.
Right.
Or possibly Robert Crumb.
Sure. Sure. I think he would fall under that category. Big time. Yeah. Daniel Close. Is his
name. Daniel Close. Yeah. There we go. Close. There we go. A fantastic writer.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Like a Velvet Glove, Cast an Iron. That's a great novel. It is. Good luck being a human in the world after reading that. That's gonna ruin him.
The storyline that really got to me was the girl writing poetry.
Yeah.
And she shows this guy and he just goes, this is garbage. Ugh. And it just destroys her. She stops writing poetry, if I remember correctly. It's been a while. And then you as the reader know that this guy actually is incredibly jealous of the poetry.
Right.
Because he thinks it's brilliant and he hates himself. And it's just both these characters hating themselves separately by not knowing, you know, enough about the world for themselves. And it just fantastic.
so that then it relates to the end of this movie, because, and really the end of the real Florence Foster Jenkins' life, when she kind of, when her performances at Carnegie Hall get reviewed, and she really kind of sees in black and white what people think of her. And whether or not she actually knew it is kind of unclear. Not so much in the movie. In the movie, it's pretty clear that she didn't know. But in real life, there's some inkling that she maybe did. But it was interesting to see how quickly someone can go something like another person's opinion or. To me, that was kind of devastating, that where you built your whole life around this thing and then to see what people actually think of it just felt really harsh to me.
Yeah.
It's really harsh.
I think there's a kind of pain that comes from being completely wrong about a huge part of your life that cannot be compared to any other kind of pain.
Of course, right.
Right. Like finding out that someone's been lying to you for years. Like, I remember reading Doug Stanhope's biography that he wrote, and his mother was dating this guy for years and found out that he had another family and that it wasn't his name, and that his stories about being in the war were taken from movies, you know, and that kind of thing where you have this idea of how the world functions and it turns out someone was gaslighting you or something like that, and you find out that that isn't true at all. I mean, I think that's its own special kind of torment.
Totally. You know, and the real Florence Foster Jenkins, you know, she died she had a heart attack 4 days after that performance and died like a month later, you know? And that reading that I can't imagine what that must've been like, you know?
Yeah, it may not have been that she saw a review and, you know, there's so much that we don't know, one can assume.
Right.
But it would be a very, very difficult thing, and you would try and spare someone, especially if you've already been sparing them that pain for so long.
Yeah.
There's no good point at this time. There's no good moment.
No.
And there's also a lot of truths in life. I feel like truth sometimes gets a better rap than it deserves, because I know people who want to come clean and they'll about something, and I'll be like, that's really about you.
Yeah.
Like, the other person's life isn't going to be better at all. Right. You're just going to ruin their life, if anything. But you're trying to absolve yourself of some guilt and yourself of having been lying to them in some way.
Sure. In AA, there's, I think the seventh step, maybe ninth, is you make amends. You know, everyone's familiar with that. But a big stipulation in that is unless it would do them further harm. So then that's when it only becomes about you. You only make amends when it's going to make amends, not because you're trying to get something off your chest. You know, that's a very important stipulation.
Like showing up to some guy and being like, listen, I slept with your mom.
Right.
It happened.
Yeah.
And it's just like, you know, I could have gone by the rest of my life without knowing
that. Yeah, that would have been fine. Totally.
You're the best man of my wife. Oh, that was the day.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't need to know any of that.
Did not make me feel better at all. No.
I'm glad you're sober.
Yeah, exactly. I really loved in this. I loved Hugh Grant.
Hugh Grant was phenomenal.
Great. Yeah.
He was so good.
Yeah.
I had a tendency to I don't like a lot of the films Hugh Grant has been in.
Same. Yeah, same.
I didn't like him in it. Hugh Grant did this I'm delightfully British and befuddled thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of what I thought Hugh Grant was.
Yep.
And then in this, he's not doing that shtick, if you will, at all.
Mm-hmm.
And he's great in it. So much of his acting came through in his expressions. It was very subtle, but still the right kind of over the top that made it work. He was so good in this.
I really liked
it. I didn't know he had it in him.
Yeah.
I was wrong. I stand corrected.
I really liked the kind of running gag that she thought he was a bad actor. You know, like when he would I'll recite for you, and he starts and she goes, I think I'll read.
And then, and then he says like, I could do a monologue before.
Yeah.
And
he's like, or not. Yeah. But he's actually quite good. You know, I don't know. Yeah. But that's funny.
Well, I mean, I think in the movie, at least the character says that he's good, but like will never be great.
Right.
And that he has to come to terms with that,
right,
which I think is another part of this film that is its own kind of sad and dark.
Yeah.
You know, I think, I was having a conversation with this guy that I'm writing with, and he said like, I don't mean this to be rude, so I apologize, but do you remember when you realized you weren't a genius?
Yeah.
He's like, because I remember the moment.
I do too.
And I'm like, I think a lot of artists have to go through that. When you're young, you think your ideas are phenomenal.
Yep.
You think, oh man, just wait until the world gets fucking loaded this.
Yep.
I'm going to blow minds. Yep. And then you get to a certain age, you go, oh, no.
Yeah.
There's nothing to be added.
I can hope to be good. You know, that's, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember, for sure.
A lot of greats are people who are willing to ruin their lives in order to be great.
Sure, sure. I'm just not, I'm not. You know. Yeah, that's it. That's a really interesting point, you know, is that I think everyone has that. Maybe not everyone. Maybe some people grow up. I'm sure some people grow up not thinking there's anything special about them at all.
And there are people who never grow out of thinking they're amazing, exactly. Even if they're not.
Exactly, right. But yeah, I certainly remember that, not the exact moment, but around the time where it was like, oh.
Yeah, for me it was a slow burn. Well, yeah, like the slow understanding that I did not have an immense insight to share with the world.
Right. I think I'm going to say it was about, because I always thought that I was kind of good at everything I tried, you know, and that was the thing, like, oh, I don't have to. My dad always said, and he was unfortunately right, you always try to run before you can walk. And that's always something I've done. Not so much now. I'm very conscious of it now. But I always thought, you know, I was going to be good at things right away. And the biggest moment for me was when I started doing stand-up. That was a harsh, because that's right there. You know, that is right there. That, oh, no, you're not good at this.
Yeah, you do not get encouragement right away in stand-up.
No.
Generally speaking.
Right.
I remember, actually, and it's only because I had been doing it for years before you had started.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That you were going like, hey, there's this show, I want you guys to come, and like, if I have a crowd, like, they'll book me more. So it's, and I remember reading that, this invitation you sent out, and going like, people this early.
Oh yeah.
You do not, that is something you need. You put it in your back pocket, because people will come to a show, and even if you're good, they may never come to another.
Well, that's that, I know. And that's that, that's why I hate those fucking bringer shows that everyone does.
Oh, they're awful.
Because, you know, that's the time, and I even knew it then, you know, but that's the time when no one should be seeing you is the time that you're doing those goddamn shows. And I put my parents through hell because I just needed people to come. You know what I mean? Like, I just needed people to come. Yeah. And, oh, it's terrible.
I'm lucky in that I'm so shy, and but like, I never really expected people to show up more than once. Right. And I was like, once they saw me once, they no longer had to support me.
Right.
They did their job.
Totally.
I would still ask, but I was always just like, yeah, dude, don't show up. I don't want to show up.
Yeah.
I don't want to go. I can't vouch for the rest of the show.
No.
I don't know what the rest of the show. I get generally, a lot of my friends genuinely did like my stand up. Mm-hmm. So like, they were excited to see me, but I was a tenth of the show.
Right. I know. Oh boy. Oh God.
So once I was to start putting on my own shows, I would book people that I thought were good.
Yeah.
And so I would put on some pretty good shows, but it was still hard to get people to those because they're, you know, they were burned on comedy.
Sure, sure. And that's just part of, I think doing, especially performance, is torturing the people you love. It's just, you know, and they just have to, I've done it for people, you know, I've done it for friends of mine for sure, where you just go and you're like, I support you. Yeah, so
I remember a friend of mine made a play in high school, and I did not like it.
Yeah,
and he came up, he's going like, so what'd you think? And I did that classic now thing where I was like, kept trying to find something to compliment while being honest.
Yeah.
And so it'd be like, oh man, the lighting was great. That was great lighting. And he was just like, yeah, the other person did that. Like, what'd you think of the play? And I'm like, they did the lighting. They didn't really nail the lighting. Or like, you go, the pacing.
Oh, you know, pacing.
Like, have to pick something. Oh, no. I didn't want to lie, but it was.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was. He looks back on it now and he knows it was bad.
Sure.
But I don't think he is okay with having made a bad play, even though it's high school. You made a bad play. It's high school.
Yeah, yeah.
It's fine.
Everyone does that.
I made a bad play in high school. Yeah. Come on.
Totally.
It wasn't as bad as his. His was really bad. He didn't know he was trying so desperately to sound smart that he made these sentences that had words that didn't really fit in the the sentence. And then the it made no sense.
Oh, no.
The repeat of the dialogue made no sense at certain points where you're like, what does that mean? And he'd be like, and he'd try and make
Do I know this person?
Oh, you know him.
Oh, no. I think I know who it is. I'm not going to say.
I'm not going to say his name. The name of the play, to give you an idea of how, it's the footsteps.
Okay, yeah, I know.
So, yeah. And then one of the lines was, how dare you crucify me to my own guilt? Which we bring up every now and again because we're like, that makes no sense. That's not a sense.
Yeah. Oh, that's very high school, though. It's Yeah.
Oh, super. Yeah. I made this comedy, and the scenes were all disjointed, and it got really preachy.
Yeah.
So it had these, monologues that were super, this in the world, and read stuff that I wrote back then. Oh, it's painful.
Yeah, yeah. I have,
but not as bad as it is.
I have an album that I made with a band I was in when I was 14. Oh God, dude! I found it recently and I listened to it. First of all, my voice hadn't changed yet, and so I sound weird. I sound really weird.
Yeah.
But one of the lyrics, one of the lyrics is, shackled by the vine infested void of discontent.
What?
Isn't that great? Isn't that awesome? What an idiot.
You were really, I like that line a lot. It's sort of perfect for that young angsty thing.
Isn't it?
Partially because of the six different metaphors happening.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. There's a lot going on.
You got Boyd, you got Shackles, you got Vines.
Isn't that great?
He is a Tarzan character in space, a prisoner.
Oh, my God. Yeah, now that I think about it, that song was mostly about Tarzan, about depressed Tarzan. Oh, I was laughing, though, when I put that on.
I wish I could remember some of the really bad moments in my mind, because I'm sure they were in there. I remember, the voice of God is a character, and she has a rose, and she talks about what God is, and that he's the strength in warriors, and the mind of the intellects, and the beauty left in a crushed rose, and then she steps on it.
Oh.
So it's I read too much E. Cummings or something. Yep. I don't know what was.
Yep.
but to be fair, after that, I had everything that was good happen in the play reversed. So, there was still some, no one got that because I didn't spell it out well enough, but.
I see. Gotcha. But it was still better than his.
Still better. Because at least the sentences made sense.
Still harping on it. What, 20 years later, something like that?
I still make jokes, but I have to stretch him out because he gets genuinely upset, and I totally know that feeling.
Oh yeah,
are things that I think about that really shouldn't be a big deal, and they make my stomach churn.
Oh yeah,
and I get embarrassed all over again.
Sure, and you laugh a little bit along with it when people are making fun of it, and then after a while you're like, all right, let's.
I need to be able to sleep tonight.
Yeah, so I get it.
Yeah.
I'm also
so that's the thing too, is a lot of these artists that are going out there and putting themselves on the line, that is so difficult. So the idea that you would ever vehemently mock someone in a not loving way is so douchey, because I love this friend that made the play, and I kind of love the play,
sure,
because it was really them putting themselves on the line, and Tommy Wiseau was really trying to do something, and Florence Foster Jenkins was to put yourself out there.
Yeah.
As we were just discussing comedy and how difficult it is in the beginning, is so hard. And that's part of the reason why we do the podcast the way we do, is we're not telling you what is and isn't good.
Right.
And we're not trying to tell people what they should and shouldn't like, because it's just so difficult to make something that the idea that these people sit around and tell you its value is right. So douchey.
Totally. I think the only thing that we have said maybe that we didn't like was Pink Flamingos. And I think that that's, it's not even that we didn't like it. It's just, it was incredibly unpleasant. You know, we just couldn't recommend it in any good conscience.
And with Pink Flamingos too, I said that like, I couldn't like it.
Right.
And that was the difference between that. Like I wanted to, because right. There's a lot to like about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I love the artist that made it, but no, I couldn't do it.
Nope. Well, Florence Foster Jenkins, the person and the film itself, which I found very enjoyable, endlessly watchable. I actually may watch it again with my wife today, but definitely overrated.
Overrated. Meryl Streep got her 20th Oscar nomination. More Oscar wins than any other actress
yep.
in Hollywood history, I believe. And Hugh Grant came out of retirement to make this film that is completely overrated.
Overrated. All right. Well, join us again next week when we'll be talking about a couple other. I don't think we've quite decided yet, but a couple other.
We still got more films that are about music that are not musicals.
Absolutely. And then so join us next week. Actually, and now I think at this point it's safe to say that we are on. Let's do a little plug. That we're now.
Oh, we're on iTunes.
Yeah, we're on
YouTube.
We're on iTunes. We're on the YouTube on the old YouTube, and we also have a SoundCloud at soundcloud.com/overratedpodcast. We also, if you go to our Facebook page, facebook.com/overratedfilmpodcast, it will come up there. Like it, say hello, check out some of the other bonus content we put up there, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And until next time, I'm Michael J. O'Connor.
James Fluty.
I'll see you next week.